I'm Ann Artis. I'm director of the College of Arts and Sciences Interdisciplinary Humanities Research Center and deputy dean in the college. And I want to welcome you to the first of this year's Public Humanities in a Digital World lectures. This series is hosted by the Research Center's Digital Humanities Working Group and co-sponsored by the University of Delaware Library, IT Academic Technology Services, the College of Arts and Sciences, the Department of English, Hagley Museum, and the Library Company of Philadelphia. So the first thing I need to do today is thank our partners in this enterprise. Susan Brinteson, the Vice Provost and Mae Morris Director of the University of Delaware Library, is very generously supporting digital humanities teaching and research initiatives on this campus in very palpable ways that extend beyond this lecture and workshop series. And she's been fully supportive of the library staff's participation in the DH Working Group for the last 18 months, their efforts to establish a digital humanities subject guide in the library, and the Multimedia Design Center's development of DH training workshops for students and faculty. Paul Hyde, director of IT's Academic Technology Services Group, does everything possible to stay out of the limelight, but I want to do a loud shout out to him here because of all of his behind the scenes work helping coordinate PR for this series and for last year's series as well. George Watson and Matt Kinservick in the college ventured down to Myth with me and a number of other people in the college's leadership team a year and a half ago now to learn about how Maryland supports digital humanities activities. And George in particular reminds me on a regular basis in the kindest possible way about the importance of financial as well as programmatic partnerships in leveraging interdisciplinary innovation and collaboration. The College of Arts and Sciences is especially lucky at this juncture in the history of the English department, I think, to have John Ernest at the helm of the department. The department has recently chosen to rethink the requirements for the PhD with an eye for supporting students' interests in the digital humanities and preparing them for better for some of the new kinds of employment opportunities that digital humanities projects are opening up in libraries, in museums, as well as in higher education. And faculty projects in that department are beginning to emerge that are raising new sorts of resource issues as well. So John has, in other words, very, very important English department specific issues related to digital humanities research and teaching initiatives that he's trying to figure out for the department. But I want to thank him here for helping to finance this series as a set of teachable moments for the campus community more broadly. Finally, my thanks go to Eric Rao, Director of Library Services at Hagley Museum and Library, and co-director with Arwin Mohan, who's also now our chair of the History Department. But Eric and Arwin have co-directed the University of Delaware's Public Humanities Summer Institute for Material Culture students. And Eric Dunbar Armstrong, oh gosh, I'm mortified, it's taped forever. Director of the Program in African American History at the Library Company of Philadelphia. Eric and Erica have been members of the IHRC's Digital Humanities Working Group since its inception, but in their administrative roles at Hagley and the Library Company of Philadelphia, they've been instrumental this year in engaging several of this year's speakers who will be giving talks at Hagley as well as at the Library Company before coming to UD. So that's an important bit of housekeeping business. Thank you to all of the units that are represented here. Cell phone check. Everybody on silence, please. Before introducing Jennifer, let me also say something about the genesis of this lecture and workshop series. The DH Working Group has been meeting since spring 2012 to talk about the transformations in scholarly communication practices that are underway in 21st century research, teaching, and learning environments. Last year's Perspectives on Digital Humanities lecture and workshop series, which was hosted by the DH Working Group but co-sponsored by the library, ITATS, the college, and the Department of English, provided hands-on training opportunities in TEI and other DH technology tools and served as a showcase for current UD digital humanities projects. And like this series, it also brought to campus major figures in the field to give public lectures, all of which are archived through UD Capture and are easily accessible on the IHRC's website, on topics ranging from issues of copyright and open access to metadata design to the unique challenges of more publicly facing research in the humanities and the emergence of alternative academic careers. This year's series continues that effort to both showcase and inventory. We're still doing kind of inventory of UD faculty and student interests in DH research and teaching projects. And it's also committed to trying to enliven our campus conversations through bringing in external speakers that are nationally and internationally recognized experts on these issues. But this year's series is also, and very intentionally, more focused on infrastructure issues, institutional infrastructure issues, the how-tos of developing and sustaining for the long haul, digital humanities research and teaching projects, the how-tos of project management and intra and inter-institutional collaboration in humanities fields where the research conventions and the institutional practices of these fields are still designed to support solo researchers, the efforts of people working on their own in their classrooms or in the library on their own. The issues related to authorship, intellectual property, and copyright in collaboratively authored, publicly facing research environments, these are things that the cultures of our disciplines are still grappling with, don't have sorted out neatly already. So it's important in that regard that we have the benefit of people like Jennifer Guiliano helping us sort of think our way into this future. So given the focus of this year's whole series, I think Jennifer Guiliano is the perfect first speaker. It's really my pleasure to introduce her this afternoon. Dr. Guiliano received a Bachelor of Arts in English and History from Miami University, a Master of Arts in History from Miami, a Master of Arts in American History a Master of Arts in History from Miami, and a Master of Arts in American History from the University of Illinois. So you made that switch before completing your PhD in History at Illinois in 2010. She currently serves as the Assistant Director at the Maryland Institute for Technology and the Humanities, and she's an affiliate of the National Center for Supercomputing Applications. She has served as a postdoctoral research assistant and program manager at the Institute for Computing in the Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences at the National Center for Supercomputing Applications, and as associate director of the Center for Digital Humanities and a research assistant professor in the Department of History at the University of South Carolina. Currently, in her role at MIF, she is I want to load up all of the network connections so that people understand just how well networked you are.
Oh, Lord.
She's also currently serving on the Executive Council of the Association for Computing in the Humanities as co-director with Trevor Munoz of the Digital Humanities Winner Institute, as adjunct instructor with the new Digital Cultures and Creativity Program at Maryland, which has been in place now maybe
three years.
And she has co-authored with Simon Appleford devdh.org, which you're going to be talking about a little bit tonight, which is a major new resource for digital humanities project development that came out of last year's Winter Institute. Dr. Guiliano's postdoctoral work contributes to the growing discipline of digital humanities through her explorations of how computing transforms both the questions that humanists can ask as well as the answers that can be generated with digital tools, methods, and pedagogies. Her day-to-day job, her day-to-day responsibility at MIF focuses on project development, including grant writing, project management, staff supervision, and aiding the MIF team in their digital humanities endeavors intra-institutionally as well as inter-institutionally. Her talk today is entitled Building and Sustaining a DH Agenda, Origins, Developments, and Options. We're going to hear a bit about that, sort of the birth story of MIF, but also the future that it's taking itself and the field into going forward. So please join me in welcoming Jennifer Guiliano.
All right. Thank you for having me, especially as the first speaker. I hope I don't scar you too much so that you avoid the rest of the series. When Anne and I first started corresponding about sort of what she wanted me to do in the 2 days I was here, one of the things that she sort of said was, it's so weird that you have this weird double life. You're a historian, you know, I've got a PhD in history, I have all the traditional research background, you know, I have fields in US history, race, ethnicity, cultural hybridity, US transnational sport, and yet, like 7 years ago, you made this weird turn into this thing called digital humanities, and you learned how to do things like balance budgets, and run divisions, and write lots and lots of grant applications. The current number at the moment, because I always like to start with this, because people look at me and they think, you look really young, how do you actually know, you know, why should I listen to you? The current number right now for me, in my own research as a PI or as a co-PI, is about $800,000 in federally awarded money that's just on my projects, and another $1.6 million in projects where I serve as senior personnel or have grant written for the project. So there's about $2.2 million in funding behind the things I'm going to talk about today. And part of this for me is sort of to start really clearly by saying, you know, the field of digital humanities is something that everybody wants to argue about. So the origins of our story oftentimes read as little sort of snapshots that get published in the newspaper or in Chronicle articles, or that your dean or your department chair may sort of drop in a meeting reference, or your advisor may say to you, you really need to get on this DH thing because that's where the jobs are. Andrew Prescott at King's College London calls it the future of the past, which is a bit of an oxymoron to some extent. Stephen Ramsey, a great colleague at the University of Nebraska, calls it the hottest thing in humanities. And Mark Sample, who was at George Mason but is now at Davidson College, calls digital humanities an emerging recession-proof, bubble-proof, bulletproof field in the academy. You know, obviously, looking at these three quotes, naysayers would sort of look at this and say, have you all lost your mind? Like, we still don't understand what you do, much less why we should be supporting what it is. And those who are proponents will say, of course we're the hottest thing. You know, we've gotten you out of the dusty archives and out of only talking to each other, and we're going to do all this sort of public-facing work where, you know, all of a sudden, you know, the sixth grade boy walking down the street is really going to want to engage with Shakespeare, or is going to, you know, wake up tomorrow morning and think TEI encoding is the coolest thing he can learn how to do. I always like to start here, in part because when we talk about building and sustaining a digital humanities agenda, what we're really talking about is a vision. It's a vision of who we want to be as an individual scholar. It's a vision of who we want our projects to be in terms of how they represent us as scholars or as a department or as a university. But it's also about how our university portrays itself to the community around it. And so today what we're going to do is walk a little bit through some of myths, history, the good and the bad. We're going to talk about pros and cons of having DH centers and sort of how they work, but we're also going to talk more specifically about, as an individual scholar, you know, how do you actually begin to craft and sustain something that other people can believe in? So I always like to start with a definition, to some extent, of what a digital humanities center is. Because if you ask around, people can point to one, but they often don't know what really goes into it. So you guys came down 18 months ago to talk to Myth to get a sense of what builds myths. We like to start with a mission statement or a definition of what digital humanities is. Because to some extent, until you know what you believe in or you know the types of digital humanities work you want to do, you're not going to know what resources you need, what support you need, what financial mechanisms you have to have. And to do that, you actually need some perspective on the digital humanities landscape. That's why a lecture series like this, or a campus reading group, or going to one of the major conferences, or coming to a training institute like we run or that the University of Victoria runs, is a really great thing, because that perspective is going to tell you what you need to know. You know, what are they really doing in these particular areas, and is my type of scholarship going to fit with that? You know, so if I'm a scholar of 20th century US history focusing on African American community life, you know, what are the DH technologies that can enable me to do my analysis or can tell me new things about the communities that I'm studying? And so you want to have some perspective about what everybody else is doing so that when you discard it and go your own direction, you at least can say that you looked at it and you disagreed. And you'll notice that that's a lot of the sort of rhetoric around digital humanities and building digital humanities right now. It's sort of, I looked at it, I didn't like what you did, so I'm gonna go create my own thing over here. And what you're gonna hear from me tonight is creating your own thing is a great idea, but you should honor the past and the people who come before you and honor the people that are trying to do it around you, because otherwise, just like when you write a book that nobody reads, it's not gonna be very useful. And that's where clear goals come into play. You know, what should you as a scholar or a digital humanities center have? You should have some sort of goals. So the goal for this year is for you guys to run a series of lectures on infrastructure and building and understanding infrastructure. But you might have other goals. They can be small local goals. You know, we need to identify everyone on campus who works in digital humanities, or we need a list of all the dissertations that are being worked on, or all the courses that are engaged with things that are even remotely digital humanities. You know, those are sort of local, low-hanging fruit that you can do as sort of a first step towards a goal. But you also sort of want bigger goals. You know, how do you want your peer institutions to view you? You know, so you as the University of Delaware, you know, when you look at your competitors around, what are they known for? What are you known for? And how do you capitalize on what you're known for in a digital space? When I teach this class in a week-long version, oftentimes by the time my students get to day two or three, they come to me and say they feel like they've sat in a public relations class. Because to some extent, being a good scholar and building a digital humanities agenda is about being your own advocate. It's about publicizing the work that you're doing, the interventions that you're making, and thinking cohesively about how you can publicize and help the work of those around you. And that's where a DH Center is very useful, and that's why we like to talk about finding the right partners. So for example, if you're interested in TEI, the right partners are right up the road at Northeastern University. You've got the Women's Writers Project. You've got other projects that sort of have set the landscape and defined what the best versions and practices of TEI are. Those are the kind of people that you email and you say, I'm starting a project. Do you have any advice for me? Or, for example, you have a great local resource like a cultural heritage institution that does really cool things with material culture objects. That's when you write them and you say, you know, we've got scanning technology. What if we came in and digitized some of the things you guys have in-house? You have great diaries, or you have great family histories, or you have these incredible resources. Those are all good first steps to thinking about who your partners could be, okay? And I'm gonna talk a little bit about myths partnership in a minute and sort of who we have as partners and how we work. The one that always makes the deans happy when I talk about this is you must have a financial model. One of the ways that I start to get people thinking about financial models is to ask them how much time and money they've invested in their own work over the course of the last year. How many hours have you put into your article, your book, your class that you're teaching to the class that you're taking? Do you know what your hourly rate is? Do you? Most people don't. And yet, you need to know what you cost to know if it's worth your time and money. So one of the first things Anne had to do was ask me, Jennifer, how much does it cost for you to come do this? I know down to the penny how much money I lose anytime I have to take vacation time from my job. And then I add 10% because I have to travel, and that adds on time. And I have to find, you know, daycare for home, or I have to find somebody to watch the dog, or I know down to the penny what I cost. One of the reasons why I like to talk about financial models, and we're going to get into this, is that when I was a graduate student, I got waitlisted to go to graduate school at Illinois. And in fact, I was told when I got there, you really might want to find another profession, because you just don't quite have what it takes to be a scholar, because you think too much about what time it takes to do something. If you're a scholar, you should be passionate and be willing to put thousands and thousands and thousands of hours into your projects. And I had the temerity to say as a first-year graduate student that I wanted to have a personal life and that it was important to me to go home and see my father's soccer team play in state. And so I was going to turn my stuff in early because I was jetting as soon as I possibly could. Knowing how much I cost allows me to make those decisions. And to some extent, for you guys, as you're thinking about your digital humanities agenda, you need to think about what it costs every time six or seven of you are in a room together talking about a project. Because let me tell you, when you go to write that first grant, you should say, the University of Delaware has already put in X number of dollars in in-kind services just to get this project up and off the ground. Every time you meet, you track your time because your time is worth money to a funder, and that signals commitment. And I'm going to tell you a lot of little things like this that people always say don't really matter. But let me tell you, when I write a grant that says, you're going to give me $30,000 and I've already put in $60,000 worth of staff time into this project, reviewers are a lot more willing to give me the 30 grand. You know, they're a lot more willing to sort of take a flight and, you know, play with some vision that I have about what we're going to do. And part of this is about, you know, the financial model is about the products that you're going to sort of give as a digital humanities group or as a center. You know, what is it that people can walk away with when they come to this? So today they're going to walk away with a lecture and a video of me talking, but what are they going to walk away with out of a meeting or an evaluation of your project or your class? You know, we do this with learning outcomes all the time when we teach, but we don't really do this with our own research. We just say, oh, there's going to be a book 6 years down the road, or there's going to be an article that's going to come out in a year. Well, one of the things we're going to talk about a little bit is about how you think about your products as an important sort of sustainability agenda for your center. Every time you do a task associated with your project, you should think about, who can I give this to so that they learn more about my project, and where can I put it so that in 5 years somebody could come study what we've done? And Tracy's heard me give this speech in a one-hour version. It's an interesting speech, but you know, what are the products of your center, or what are the products of what you're gonna do? So there's some pros to having a center. A lot of times when I go give talks, particularly at what we call low resource schools, which are those schools that don't have the huge science wings and the big, you know, legal departments and all of that, they say, well, you're at myth. Like, you sit at the one of the oldest schools, you know, oldest centers. You have no idea what it's like to struggle. I will tell you that everybody struggles regardless of whether you have a center or not. And so there's some pros to having a center on your campus. You know, it creates a physical and an intellectual space for people to come. You know, it's pretty easy when somebody wants to start doing DH on Maryland to walk into our offices and say, can you tell me about? The number of times I've come to work in the morning and there's some random graduate student or undergraduate student looking at our bookshelves, for example, making lists of what Matt Kirschenbaum reads and is on his bookshelf is actually pretty high. It's kind of impressive. It allows you to also have dedicated personnel. You know, we oftentimes don't have to go looking for a computer programmer, or don't have to go looking for a graphic designer. But just because we have them in-house doesn't actually mean that they're free. So let me tell you, every time I want to have a conversation with my staff about a project I have an idea for, that costs us money, and I have to pay for it. Just because I'm in a center doesn't mean I get it for free. And part of that's because that's the way the academy works. You know, the academy needs revenue to support what it's doing, and so it's expected at the end of the day that your budget is an equal budget, that you are living in the black. Digital Humanities Center also support independent activities. This is one of my favorites, which is when you have a Digital Humanities Center available to you, you can do things like completely disregard what the other faculty in your department want to do, because you go work with the Digital Humanities Center. You say, I don't really care that you're uninterested in my project on Native American treaties. I'm going to go take it to the DH Center because I know they think it's cool. So I don't have to worry about you until I come up for tenure. And by then, my project's going to be so well known that, you know, of course I'm going to get tenure. It serves as a brand for your institution. The number of people who actually can identify that the Maryland Institute for Technologies is at the University of Maryland is actually pretty low. Most people think MIT just is in DC somewhere. And then when they give them directions to the University of Maryland College Park, they say, I had no idea you were here. You know, to some extent, we have a better brand than our institution does. But it also creates a sort of solid or independent infrastructure for projects. And this is what the greatest benefits of having a DH center is, that you've got people already on the ground who've thought through things like, where's the data stored? How do you put it on the web? How do you actually deal with metadata? And across the board, actually, this is the thing that when people say they want a DH center, that's really what they want. They don't really care about the vision or the dedicated personnel. They want somebody to figure out that infrastructure piece for them, because that's the hard piece. And that's the thing that you guys on this campus are just starting to do, and you realize how hard this is. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how you sort of get these pieces in play. But there are some cons to having a DH center. And I'm actually in the process of trying to write this up as an article because I'm tired of answering the question of why you would avoid having a DH center. The first one is actually high financial overhead. Let me tell you, we have a number of staff members. Anytime I have my boss in the room, It runs us almost $700 an hour between his salary, benefits, and other associated things that we lose money on because he's in the room. You know, we have people that depend on us for their livelihood. So if I don't bring in enough grant money every year, people lose their jobs. That's the downside to a center that sometimes we forget. It can also become a silo. And this is what I like to call the single project problem. How many of you guys, when you look at a digital humanities center, only think of one project? Or maybe two. So how many people, and I'll pick on my colleagues right down the road at the Center for History and New Media, who I love, they know I love them. When people say the Center for History and New Media, Omeka and Zotero, do you know that they have 20-some other projects? Very few people pay attention to those other 20-some projects. And there are centers like that all over the place. IHAS, who I used to work for, the Institute for Computing and the Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences at the University of Illinois, they're a high-performance computing center in the digital humanities. Very rarely can anyone name a single project that they have. But they can say the words high-performance computing, and now they can say a second word, which is XSEED, which is the Blue Waters petascale computer program that allows you to get computing time. Can't tell you what a project is, but we can tell you there's something that they're doing over there. My ex-boss and I have had lots of conversation about this single project problem for him. The other cons of a DH center is you become reliant on soft money to grow. You know, we get a certain amount of money from the college, and I'm going to talk about exactly how much money we get, because you're going to be surprised at how low the number actually is. Any dollar over that money has to come in through grants, or through partnerships, or through funding streams. So we constantly write grants. My first year at MIF, how many grants do you think we wrote as a center? Five, maybe?
20.
13. I wrote 11 of the 13. Do you know how many times and how much effort it takes to write 13 different project applications? Some of whom have 25-page narratives. Some of whom, thank God, only have 3-page narratives. I love those. Last year, we only had to write 5 because we were so successful with the 13 that last year, I only had to worry about 5 to cover our whole. But I know down to the dollar what we have to do to make sure that our staff stays employed. That's not fun, because when things happen like Congress loses their bloody mind and closes down the federal government, all of the grant cycles are delayed. So we're now losing money every day that Congress stays closed because NEH can't award the next set of grants. Unintended consequences of living on soft money. It also means, when you live on soft money, that oftentimes you're already looking ahead to the next thing before you finish the one thing you've done. Super frustrating when, as a scholar, you want to stop and enjoy the roses of your project, and you just want to live in it for a little while and breathe and see it grow. And unfortunately, you're already 6 weeks into your next project. The example I like to give on this soft money thing is I'm in the process of trying to make the move into a tenure line position, and was told that the best thing to do to get the university to open a tenure line position for me would be to complete my authored monograph, which is true. So I spent 3 months this summer where I worked 2 days a week, and the other 5 days a week, I authored my monograph and sent it off to press on September 1. That was bad enough, but along the way, I was told it also would be really good if you could up your international profile a little bit. So I taught a week-long intensive summer school at the University of Victoria, and then 4 weeks later did it again in Leipzig, Germany. Probably not the best idea, because I signed a book contract for a second book at the same time, because I was told, you know what, one book is good, two books is gonna get you tenure. So I turned in one book on September 7th and started the next one on September 9th. Soft money ain't fun to live on for anybody. And unfortunately, the way that the reward structures work in the academy, you have to be attentive to things like how you schedule your time and how much it costs, and you know what happens when you ask the dean or the provost to come in to sit with you to talk about something. Every time you have them in there is an opportunity for you to get support for your center, your project, your ideas. It makes it difficult to be agile if you work in a center. Oftentimes, you've hired staff and they have specific things that they're good at, and that's all they're good at. I don't code, which is always a revelation to people. You know, I do some CSS and some HTML. I'm trying to teach myself PHP as a hobby, but I don't code. I don't. So if we run out of coders to work on projects, it's not like my boss can turn to me and say, hey, Jen, boot up your computer, get going. fork that repository on GitHub. We need some work done. It's not going to happen. In the same way that my CS colleagues that I work with aren't probably the best people to go talk to the general public about the humanities meaning of some of our projects, because they're not quite comfortable standing up in public talking to an audience. There's a tension, too, in most centers between self-interest and the interest of the field. You know, these are the things we want to do as a center, and we don't really care what the field says. So I always think about these as the one-off centers. We have one thing we do really good, and we're just going to do it over and over and over again. And we're not really going to worry about innovating anything new. We're just going to do the one thing we're good at over and over and over again. That's not a bad thing to do. But if the field keeps moving and you don't, you get left behind a little bit. And oftentimes when we talk about the demise of DH centers or centers as a whole, it's because of this. They're doing one thing so well that they have 20 projects to do that one thing really, really well, and they sort of never keep moving with the field. And finally, and this is the biggest problem, the infrastructure must be maintained. The minute you buy a computer or buy a server, somebody has to maintain it. So it's not just that you got $5,000 from NEH to buy a computer to use with your project. There has to be money in there for somebody to come in and fix the computer when it breaks, or to put it on the university network, or to do the backups and the checkups and the servers and all the things that come with it. It's not quite as simple as it sounds, which is why you guys are working on figuring out your infrastructure. So Myth. This is our lovely new space in Myth. It did not used to look like this. In fact, we started, those of you guys who came to visit Myth before last year, we were in a 1,200 square foot basement room with a single window that, I'm not kidding you, was about the size of my head. In the winter, it would rain in the window when the snow melted. In the summer, we had all kinds of lovely bug issues because we were in the basement of a library, and so they would be carting things in and out constantly. We lived in cubicles, floor-to-ceiling cubicles. There were no phones for the staff, unless you had a private office, and only two staff members had a private office. We would host Digital Dialogues, which is our weekly lecture series, and we'd stick 45 people in a room built for 12. Literally having students lining the hallways outside the room with people yelling, "He just said TEI!" Not quite conducive, because when people would come to visit, they would say, "But this is Myth. You guys were founded in 1999 with a challenge grant. You had these great directors in Martha Nell Smith and Neil Freistadt. You guys are world renowned for what you do. Why are you in a hovel in the basement?" And through soft money, through us raising enough money to pay for our projects and our staff, we were able to put away some money and renovate space in the other library. So this used to be library stacks. This was unwanted space that Dean Steele, Pat Steele, and the libraries gave to us and said, if you can afford to renovate it, you can have it. And everybody said, what are you guys thinking? You know, it was horrible, like it was so dirty and just gross, and I mean, just the worst space ever. It looks out onto a beautiful courtyard with no access that you can't use. You can't get in and out of it. It's inside non-print media, which means you deal with all the undergrads who come to watch TV all day long. It's not exactly a destination on campus. And so they said, here, have it. So we raised $200,000. We got a couple of campus grants to support about another $1,000 worth of renovation. And we created a space that worked for us. So there's some unique features to our space. This little thing back here, that's kind of hard to see, that bright green wall, there's actually a garage door there that goes up and down, because we couldn't afford to redo asbestos and HVAC issues in our space. So we met with a design firm called Gensler in Baltimore, and we talked to them about what our options were, because we weren't allowed to put walls in anywhere. So we went to an open office concept. How many of you guys have ever tried to work in an open office concept as a scholar? How easy is it to read a book or have a phone conversation? So we actually had to create two small rooms along the back of the space, and you really can't sort of see them in these photos. We have two small rooms in the back that are called huddle rooms that are actually just got soundproof 3 weeks ago. The Lord. Because before, when you'd have a conversation or a conference call, everybody in the office could hear you. What you really don't want to have is your entire office hearing you talk about people not doing their jobs. Like, not quite the best thing ever. But we also integrated things like display space. So we have a number of born digital and early electronic literature collections. So that's what's displayed here along the wall. you know, we sort of went, you can see the big long wall of bookshelves. But what's amazing to people is when they think of MIS, they think of a center that's absolutely giant. Because they come into this beautiful space, it's actually now a destination on campus, so they bring tour groups through our space, which is quite odd and weird, because nobody wanted to give us to us and nobody wanted to fund us, but now they, like the deans and the provost and the, like they bring people through, like, look at our innovative collaborative space, because collaboration is the big word that your academy wants to talk about. Look at this space, it's so pretty. They have no idea what we do, but it looks really pretty. Look at how pretty it is, it's so pretty. But we're actually really not that big of a shop. So in this room, you guys actually have more people in this room than we do in all of MIS. It's kind of amazing. Right now, and this actually just got updated 2 weeks ago, we have 10 positions total spread across a number of employees. So we have 6 directors, which actually only is the equivalent of 4.5 people, because we have a number of people who have joint positions, 1 in the library and 2 in the Department of English. So I and my other colleague at the assistant level are the only 2 full-time directors at MIS. We're the only ones there constantly. We have 3.5 full-time programmers, 2 of whom are professional programmers. The rest are graduate students that we contract to do work. We have a half-time, 20-hour-a-week graduate graphic design person who is absolutely fabulous. This is a good example of invention being useful. How she came to us was from referral from another employee. And she's okay with not making the money she does in her private business because she gets health care. So we have a deal with her. She comes to work 1 day a week for 8 hours. The rest of the time, she works from home. She does everything with us asynchronously. We assign her tasks on Basecamp. Conversations occur in Basecamp. We don't see her unless we have to, basically. But she gets health care, so we get professional level graphic design at a quarter of the price because she needs health care. She can't afford it on her own for her own business. We now have a full-time program manager, Stephanie Sapienza, who just started with us. She is now my godsend. So before, I used to grant write and project manage and do it all. And now there's somebody that does all my detail work for me with our projects. So I set the agenda for the projects and say, this is where I want to be. And she figures out how to turn everything into itemized to-do with deadlines and due dates. And she runs those all down. Whereas I used to have to send angry emails or angry Basecamp posts. Why did you miss your deadline? You didn't fork the repository. You didn't show up when you were supposed to. Now I have somebody else who gets to do that for me, which is quite lovely. And we have 1 half-time graduate assistant who does our server administration. We're in a 12-month process of converting to WordPress multi-site to make our infrastructure cleaner and simpler for maintenance purposes. She works half-time for us 20 hours a week doing all of our server stuff on. We have 2 servers. We have 30-some projects. It's all a great big mess. Part of it when we talk about centers or founding a center is that the field is getting much more crowded. So when I started in digital humanities 7 years ago, there were maybe a handful, 6 to 8 centers in the US. This is as of October 2012, new centers and initiatives that have been founded in the US alone. They're specking right now that in another 5 years, we're going to be talking hundreds of centers around the globe. You have to figure out for your university and your projects and your faculty what your version of DH is, because you need to know who you're competing against. It's just like when you're trying to recruit great undergrads to your university, you talk about all the really great things they can do at the University of Delaware that they can't do elsewhere. You need to do the same thing with your digital humanities agenda. What is it that they can do here that they can't do elsewhere? And I'll talk about how you identify those little things as we go further along. So how do we get started actually building an agenda? At MIS, we started building an agenda in 1999 with Martha Nell Smith, who is a scholar of women's studies. She is famous for the Emily Dickinson Archive. And it started with Martha's project. And because MIS started with Martha's project, for the first 6 years of MIS's existence, it ran on individual faculty fellowships and projects brought to us by faculty. So a faculty member on campus would decide they wanted to be a digital humanist. They'd show up at MIS's door. MIS would give them a bunch of graduate students and a bunch of undergraduate students and a bunch of contract workers and say, go build them their project, which works really well to get the project up and running. But where it doesn't work very well is it's not sustainable. Because you know what? That faculty member goes back to their department and then wonders how they're going to pay for the digital project that they've just had created. So how many of you guys have done the favorite thing that I love to do, which is open up an old Word document in the newest version of Word, and you get all the gobbledygook? Or you open up an old website, and the navigation menus are all screwy? One of the biggest misconceptions people have when we talk about what type of digital humanities that they do is that they think that they only do digital humanities once on a project. I start a project with one technology, and in 25 years, that technology is going to work again. Not true. Right now, what we tell people is you build a project now, and within 3 to 5 years, you're going to have to reconceptualize and rebuild it with new technologies. So everybody used to love, you know, HTML, regular HTML, and then everybody went to Java and Flash. So you had all those pop-up windows and all those pretty graphics that danced. 3 years later, they came back and said, those aren't accessible. They're not useful. You can't use them on iPads and mobile devices. So now we're back to HTML. So there's all kinds of projects littering the DH landscape that were built with technologies that are no longer useful for scholars. So when we talk about sort of what type of digital humanities you want to do, the biggest thing that I want to say to you is this. It doesn't really matter what your mission statement says. It does, because people kind of want to know what they can come to you for. What it matters is what you believe in terms of your project. So this is MIF's mission statement. And I've highlighted a couple of key things. We specialize in text and image analytics for cultural heritage collections. So that's one. Data curation, that's two. Digital preservation, that's three. Linked open data applications, that's four. And data publishing, that's five. Five's a lot. But we've actually lost our mind even more, because then we say, we're actually going to create frameworks for those five things. We're going to develop new methods and new tools, so that's two. We're going to do applied research. So we're not just going to build it, we're actually going to try and use it repeatedly, which is a lot harder than it sounds. We're going to preserve them once we've done them and archive them. We're going to encourage others to use them. So we have five research areas with five different things we try and do with those five areas. So a lot of times when people come to MIF, they say, I want to do this one thing here and do item number four. Well, the reality is we don't have enough people, enough time, or enough staff. So we set priorities. And that's where I actually want to start you guys with in terms of thinking about how you build your agenda. What is your priority as a scholar, as a student, as an administrator? You know, what are the things you're personally committed to? That's where you start in building a DH agenda. So there's five questions when I teach this to graduate students and undergrads in particular that I like to ask to sort of get them started. What are you passionate about? You know, so when you're sitting around having a beer with friends or family and they want to have a conversation with you, like, what's that thing you always go to? For me, I love sports. Grew up with them. My dad's a soccer coach, played volleyball, basketball, ran track, swam. I love sports. I'm passionate about how Americans are involved with sport and have laden it with all kinds of racial and class and gendered implications that just are so ooky and fun to deal with. So I create projects about those things, because when I come home at the end of the day, I'm watching TV for SportsCenter, I'm reading ESPN, I'm doing those things that I'm passionate about. So start by asking yourself, what are you passionate about? It could be as a person, as a teacher, as an administrator. That's a good place to start when you think about building a DH agenda. And the one that is always fun is, if you had all the time in the world, what would you do? So when you get the day off of work, and you're at home in your apartment, and all the cleaning is done, and the family's taken care of, and the dog's put out, what's your go-to thing that makes you happy? What's that thing when you close your eyes, you say, if I could do anything and won $1 million for the rest of my life, this is the thing that I'm going to do. That should be your DH agenda. So I have a colleague who once said to me that all they really wanted to do was understand how their town became the way it was, because they had a town that was a sundown town. That's all he wanted to understand, was how, when he was growing up, white people and black people didn't get along. He's now creating a DH project attempting to track how the town became a sundown town through maps. That's a good example of how something he's passionate about figuring out in his own life becomes a scholarly endeavor. The third is the one that actually is really useful when you're mentoring graduate students and they're sort of thinking about master's theses or dissertations or even senior level undergraduates in that capstone. What's a major issue in your field? When I illustrate this, oftentimes when I teach the big class, I talk about everybody arguing about the causes of the Civil War. Southern historians have been arguing about the causes of the Civil War since the Civil War started. I mean, seriously, like, let's be real. W.E.B. Du Bois came out and said, the Civil War is way more complicated than we believe in the 19-teens, and people said, that's really great, we're gonna keep arguing about it. Jean Genovese came out in the 50s and said, it's even more complicated. People kept arguing about it. Stephanie McCurry came out and said, it's actually about community. It's not about all these political forces, it's about communities being at war. In 1990, people are still arguing about it. What are the issues people in your field argue about? That's a really useful way to figure out what a great DH project would be. So if you look at a conference program, what are the things that are traditional papers that people are arguing about? It could be US history in the world is a big thing right now, and understanding center and periphery, not as center and periphery, but as lived experience. How would you imagine a lived experience type of project? You know, what could you do in a DH space that you can't do with a traditional book? And the final two are two that, you know, I come back to all the time. What are the skills you actually bring out to the project? And when I say skills, I don't necessarily mean you code or, you know, you have a PhD in something. I mean, I'm super organized. I'm really good with visual stuff. Or, you know what, I'm really good at talking publicly to people, so I'd be a great person to stand up and talk to everybody about what we do. You know, what are the things that you can bring to a project that aren't necessarily always the degree stuff, but are the interpersonal things? Like, I'm good at mediating between people, which, by the way, I am not. I tend to be the light everybody on fire sort, and like, let's have a big fight and an argument. But I have a colleague who's a great mediator. So inevitably, when I start going off the rails, he steps in and says, let's stop for a moment. What Jen is really saying is, after I've called somebody an asshole and moved on, you know, what skills do each of you have as a person? And this is very important when you think about how you're going to collaborate as a team. A team that has 84 scholars who all do the same thing is probably not going to be a great team. But a team where everyone has clear responsibilities and clear skills they bring to a project around an area of interest, now that's going to be a good team. And I have a whole lecture I give about team building, and we'll talk a little bit about it tomorrow, but you know, what skills can you bring? And the final one is, what are you willing to learn? And this is through, you know, my own experience with people sort of saying, well, the faculty are the faculty on the project, and the grad students are the grunts, and the undergrads just show up to, you know, make copies and do whatever. It doesn't work that way in a digital humanities project, because oftentimes the graduate students are more technologically savvy than the faculty. Oftentimes the faculty may have more knowledge or less knowledge than other people on the project. You should start from a place where everyone admits what they know or don't know and what they're willing to learn. It's important on a campus like this, particularly when you're trying to get something started. I, in my position as an IT person, know these things and can help everyone with these things. And just saying, I can help with these things, gives people clear opportunities to come talk to you. And it also gives you a way to say, I'm not interested in doing those things. You know, that's outside the scope of my job. So if you're Tracy at the History Media Center, you know, she has very specific things in her job description that she can do. If she tells everybody what those things are, then projects that are interested in doing those things can come to her. And when people come to her that are not able to do those things, she can say, I'm not the right person, but this other person over here is. And that's the matchmaking game that's very useful for digital humanities at a school like this. So there's some general trends in DH that are useful to sort of be aware of. And I know you guys have talked about some skills last year. I tend to talk about this as five things. This is the lowest barrier to entry in digital humanities, which is the one we all focus the most on, you know, producing humanistic knowledge. This is Scholar Press, which is a blogging software, Zotero, which is a citation management software, and Omeka, which is the archiving tool in the back. A good place to get started are these three tools, because you know what? You don't have to have an infrastructure. You can run it off of Omeka.net, you can host a blog off of WordPress, and you can run Zotero off of any laptop that has Firefox, because it's a plugin. So you can start producing your knowledge today without needing an IT person, without needing server space, without needing anything like that. And once you get comfortable with those things, then you can step it up and maybe, you know, buy your own server on Bluehost or on DreamHost and create your own multi-site, or you know, decide that you really are into this and you're going to do a new multimedia scalar project. You know, that's producing knowledge in new ways. good sort of barrier to entry. You know, getting in, just saying some things, figuring out what you know. And oftentimes there's little things like standards you can turn to. So the top is History Pin, which is a great fun program where you can actually drop pins and attach images to it to tell stories. And there's some really cool exhibits on like rebuilding cities on History Pin or drive memorials. When you drive along a road, they've gone through and put up pins for all the memorials. So you can see like the newspaper articles from the accident that happened there. You know, interesting ways to use information. The text encoding initiative, I know you guys had text encoding people come in last year and talk. You know, again, producing knowledge that other people can reuse. I always like to mention discovering existing knowledge. Don't think you have to create it yourself. So these are two examples of library collections that were taken and digitized and turned into massive DH projects. In the top one, this is the Old Weather Project, which is a crowdsourcing transcription project, where they digitized all of the journals from like the ship's logs, and they put them up online, and they said, everybody go on and transcribe them and map them. They've had like hundreds of thousands. I mean, at this point, it was only 25,000, but this is like a year old. You know, they've had 25,000 people transcribe those ship logs. And now they've discovered things like the currents weren't running the way they thought they were in a year, and like climatologists got super interested. Or this project at the bottom, which is from Australia. The National Library of Australia had digitized all the immigration cards. And Tim Sherratt and his collaborators went in and decided to use an algorithm that was publicly available to create these little indexing boxes to give people a new way to surf those image cards. Because when you look at the immigration card, it wasn't really interesting that the photo's all the way at the bottom and you have to know what you're looking for. So they ran an algorithm that excised all the images and you can click on each image and go back to the original immigration card. You know, that's a good example of a low-hanging fruit project where the knowledge is already out there, but you're just trying to do something a little new and a little different. So I always like to ask people, because inevitably there's librarians in the room, what types of things does your library have that other people don't in their special collections that you could digitize and play with as a group? Library journals, things like you know, photos of the campus, campus history, local community history. You know, there are community organizations in the area that you could go to and say, we want to do a history of your organization. Let's digitize that. You've got digitization centers in your library. You can do this really easily. This is a great type of project to sort of get started. And then you get towards the more complicated ends of DH. So this is analyzing knowledge. These are three projects that have been built on top of each other. So the Old Bailey project started in the late 80s, where they were transcribing the proceedings of the Old Bailey in England, which was the Central Court of London. Once they got done transcribing and encoding everything, they realized that they could start mapping it. So that's London Lies, where they went through and pulled out all of the offenses. And you could actually sort and surf London by offenses. And they found things like lots of prostitution arrests happened on this particular corner. It just so happened it was in proximity to the central like London barristers or whatever. The prostitutes, lawyers, who knows. But so this was the technology that they could work with in the early 2000s, though, is that they could begin to imagine and visualize the information a little bit differently. And in fact, when GIS became something that was a lot more easy to use and they had more infrastructure for GIS, they've actually now built onto this ways to surf this visually with GIS maps. So you can now look at individual lives and where they move, and they're beginning to connect this sort of with all kinds of other records that are available. This is where they sort of took things that they knew how to do. They digitized everything and they encoded it all, and they imagined different ways of analyzing it and visualizing it. So this is the difference, for example, when you get a textbook that is thousands and thousands of paragraphs, and you get textbooks that have things like maps and tables and graphs. Students tend to respond better when they're looking at things visually, not just textually. This is a good example of how you take one single set of data and turn it into multiple projects. Preserving knowledge. So these are three projects from Maryland. BitCurator, we've built a bunch of tools that allow you to do things like run a hard drive and tell you what's on it. How many of you guys have those, you know, old 3.5-inch floppy disks in your house and you have no idea what it is? We do a lot of work with those types of things. We actually had a project for a number of years on preserving video games. So video games are super cool, but they're also really hard to preserve because the technology and the graphics don't always work together. So you can get online and do emulators for like the Oregon Trail, which I use when I teach history. And students are like, what the hell is this? Like, it's a green screen and it's whatever. So I actually, when I teach this with my DCC kids, I make them play the original Oregon Trail on an Apple II emulator. And then we actually pull out the new Wii version and they play the new Wii version. And I tell them the story about how, in fact, about 63% of women on the Oregon Trail gave birth during their journey across country, and yet that's nowhere in the game options. So how accurate, because it gets lauded as being a great accurate historical game, and yet, historically speaking, it continues to preserve a lot of sort of tropes about men and women as they traverse the Oregon Trail. And in fact, because I specialize in Native American history as well, I also talk to them about, you know, how they always use the Plain Sioux images, even though they're Comanches that are attacking them. You know, things like that, that like, students are like, but it's a game, it's gonna teach us. And they tell us games are better ways of learning. You know, again, preserving knowledge to use it as a critique, because that's really what we do as scholars. So how do you begin to sustain your project? So you've got a couple of ideas. You know, how do you guys, as individuals and institutions, actually begin to sustain and build this? And this is what I'm gonna talk more about tomorrow as well. You wanna start by building something you can maintain yourself. In other words, if you're not somebody who's highly technical, a blog may be the best choice for you. Or a website that uses something like WordPress or Drupal, where once it's set up, it's relatively easy to maintain. You just keep hitting that update button so that you don't have any security vulnerabilities, and it tends to stay that way. You know, so start with something you can maintain yourself. Or build a team of people. So for example, you may have somebody in your department who knows how to build a website or use an algorithm or digitize some stuff. And you may say, well, if you can do the digitization, I can learn how to encode, and this other person over here is really good with GIS and can do the GIS piece. The important thing about thinking about building a team, though, is that you actually want to negotiate what everybody's responsibilities are and what everybody's authority is on the project. And when I say authority, it is this. Oftentimes, projects get built with team, and then team members move. Faculty member gets hired away. Graduate student graduates. Undergraduate student gets a new job on campus. You want to start your project as an individual with the notion that you are not going to stay at the University of Delaware for the rest of your life. So anything you build needs to be portable with you or with other members of your team. So I keep a list in every project that I build. What software did I build it in? What decisions did we make about how we were going to handle data or handle the front end? I keep lists of things like, this is how many files I have and how much size they take up. Because this way, if I get a new job, I go to my department I've just gotten hired at and I say, these are my needs for my existing projects. Can you meet them? Integrate your project into an existing one. This is something we forget a lot about as institutions or as scholars. You don't actually have to create something new yourself. You can find a project somebody's already doing and saying, I'm willing to donate time. And I'll show you guys a resource at the end where you can find existing projects and donate your time. One that's a favorite of mine is integrating your project into a course. And I know you guys are already doing that a little bit on your campus. You know, start from a place where you know you're gonna be spending 400 hours over the course of the semester teaching it. So you might as well spend the 400 hours having something that comes out of the end beyond just your students' greater knowledge and you getting a paycheck. Integrate your project into the campus infrastructure. And this is my favorite. How many of you guys have ever read your campus's strategic plan or any of the things that your president puts out? This is actually the best way to figure out what your university is going to do and how you get on board with doing it. So oftentimes, we get strategic things from the college or from the university that says things like, we want to go more towards, you know, collaborative learning for undergraduate research. So we're going to be funding a bunch of courses and putting a bunch of money into infrastructure so they can do things like virtual meetings. Well, crap, I can sit down and come up with a project that can use virtual meetings. Sure, not a problem. Knowing what your university wants to do strategically allows you to attach your projects to those things. So for example, anyone who was paying attention about 10 years ago started a project celebrating the sesquicentennial of the Civil War. Because you know what? Almost every university across the US that existed anywhere near the Civil War put a bunch of money into doing local histories of the Civil War. So they attached their project to something the university was going to do anyway. So the War of 1812 is a good one for right now, but there are others coming. You know, can you look ahead in terms of what the scholarship is going to be doing in the next 10 years and start building your project now? And finally, seek funding. And this is actually usually the default move for most people is, I gotta go find the money elsewhere. You get money elsewhere by putting time and money and energy in here, by being committed, by tracking how much money goes into things, by saying, for example, our campus is already sponsoring a lecture series on these things, so we're gonna have people capable of doing this particular type of thing. You know, people will give you money when they think you're successful. So you have to start building a narrative now that says, I'm successful, even if you really aren't. Even if you're just kind of thinking you're getting there. Winning grant money is PR. It's not actually about the value of the project, which I hate saying, and I would get killed by our funders for saying this. But it's not actually about the quality of what you're going to be producing so much as it's about the vision you're selling to people. Because the people sitting in the room to review your grant applications are people like us. If you write boring prose, they're going to fall asleep and not read it. You have to sell it like you're selling, I don't know, yourself. You know, like it's a dating site, which is what I like to use as the example. As a campus, there are things you can do, and you guys are already starting to do this. You know, build something that uses existing support systems. So you've got the library involved, you've got campus IT involved. You know, what technologies are already here on campus? Do you guys use Banner and Blackboard? Do you have WordPress available? Do you have Omeka in a lab somewhere? Do you have Adobe somewhere on campus where people could do multimedia projects? You know, those types of lists should be distributed to people so they know what's already available that they don't have to pay for. Building it across colleges is also very useful, in part because when you look, for example, at people that are doing CS or business, and you need help writing a budget, or you need students to help you on a project, you can go to a faculty member and say, I know you have undergrads that are just learning to program. How about they learn to program by building this thing I need for my project? And I've pulled this repeatedly on campuses across the United States for projects. You know, there's that beginning intro to web design class that most like advertising departments have or most CS departments have. Well, that's really great. How about we partner and my students will give you the content and your students will build it and then we all have a product at the end. You know, use the resources that already exist that you have to have every day on a college campus because you have to be serving your students. Integrate it into undergraduate education, so that's my example of that. Make it something locally interesting. You know, so do you have large churches around town, large cultural heritage organizations, museums, who would love to have people come in and build a project with them? I have a colleague who is actually doing this with like creating maps of old churches that no longer exist that have folded into other churches. And they're getting money from the current church to do that because they're interested in their history. I know of a project that has done this with graveyards, where they're going back and actually mapping graveyards. And the churches are very interested in this because they want to know where consecrated ground is, and they want to have those sort of indices of where people are buried. That's a good example where they're going with the church to get money to do this. Seeking external funding. You know, ask for money. There's nothing you can lose. And don't worry, every grant application you write can be reused 850 ways to Sunday. It gets reused as prose in your website, it gets reused in that brief you wrote for your college or your dean, it gets reused as the blurb on your project website. If you write it once, you should use it 10 times. Seriously. So we need funding. Internal funding. Oftentimes, part of the reason why I encourage projects or universities to look at building things across colleges is because this way when one college gets hit with a budget cut or the university gets hit with a budget cut, everybody shares the pain rather than one college saying you're going to lose 3 to 10%. And in fact, this happened to Myth. We got a budget cut of 5% and our response was, sure, you can have the 5% back. And oh, by the way, we just brought in $400,000. So you're going to wait till we get our $400,000. And we went to the library and said, hey, the college just cut us a little bit. We're your partner. We've just put out a bunch of projects with you. Can we get a little more help from the library this year? And the library stepped up and offered us 20% release for librarians working with us. So using cross colleges against each other, sorry to the deans in the room, is quite useful for keeping your projects and your centers up and running. Use or lose funding. You know, oftentimes we get money in a big chunk and they say you have to use this, this is your startup kitty and you have to figure out how to work. If you get $200,000 from your university, which is what MIF gets a year from our college, $200,000, which isn't even enough to pay for our directorial staff. So what we do is we don't actually invest in things that we keep forever. We buy parts of people. So in the $200,000, that pays for our directors by buying halves of people together. What constitutes a return on the investment? One of the things that's really interesting is, have you guys as a campus actually talked about what it would be to be successful in digital humanities? What is that bar that you want to hit as a university? And I ask this of projects. When we start projects, when you close your eyes and imagine what would be the best version of your project, what is it? Is it 5 users? Is it 10 users? Is it being mentioned in a local article, what is it that would be an A success? And I emphasize this when we talk about the university, because oftentimes people enter into digital humanities and they think, we just need a center. If we get a center, that's going to fix it all. Well, oftentimes, as soon as you do that, they then want you to do something better or more, or we want you to be this center over here. Have the conversation now. What do we think will be success for our campus? Is it 6 projects? Is it dissertations with graduate students? What is it that we will measure our success by? External funding, a couple of things that I always like to highlight when we talk about these things. Most humanities grants are less than $350,000 a year. The average computer science professor makes anywhere between $110,000 and $190,000 a year, depending on what institutions you're at and what their funding setups are, which means you ain't gonna buy the next Nobel Prize in CS. It's not gonna happen. Knowing how much money you have means you can stretch your dollars. You may not be able to buy that tenured faculty member, but you may be able to buy that graduate student they recommend, or you may be able to buy that undergraduate student. This is particularly important when you think about things like libraries and having libraries involved. Libraries need money to support their primary goals, which is serving students, buying more books, digitizing materials. If you get $350,000, throwing $5,000 at your library to digitize materials will generate a lot of goodwill. Cash is king, usually, on your campus. And you want to be careful of things like federal stagnation and sequester. You know, Congress is out right now, which means we're all screwed financially. You know, thinking about things like, where do I want to be with my project or my group in a year, and where do we want to be in 3 years? And having those conversations now, before you get started. And donor relations. Most people are surprised to learn that MIT actually has no external donors. We do it all on state money and grant money. So I've scared you all to death, and now I want to actually make something a little proactive for you. Where do you find the people to help you build your DH agenda? In your department or college, what technologies do we already have? So you've got the History Media Center. I'm sure you have a list of all the things you have access to.
We do.
Have you made that list publicly available outside of the History Media Center or the History Department?
We have not.
Amen. There's a resource. Again, knowing and getting people to identify and self-identify what they've got and can put on the table. You know, I have massive libraries of this type of scholarship that are, you know, somebody could come borrow if they needed to, or I have a friend or a colleague who could do these sorts of things. You know, what do you already have? What skills do you have? In this room alone, I'm guessing you have at least one person who knows how to build a website. I'm guessing you have at least one person who knows how to digitize material. And I'm guessing you've got at least a dozen people who have opinions. That right there is your first digital humanities project in this room alone. Again, self-identifying. So we're actually gonna start with this activity in the morning where everyone has to identify what they're good at. It's quite entertaining to see what people have. And can you buy expertise from other departments or other universities even? You know, we don't have it here, it's too expensive, so buy it from someplace else. That's totally valid and logical when you're building capacity. At the university level, what does campus IT have available? Every campus and their mother has someone who specializes in legal and copyright issues because they have to because of HIPAA. Find out who that person is. Every campus IT usually has somebody that has to deal with the servers because you have to have email to deal with undergrads and have a university run. Find out who that person is. What email clients do we have? What servers do we have? Can I buy server space from the university? Probably. You just have to ask. Usually they can tell you what it costs. Well, geez, then you already get a structure that works. They're already backing it up. They already know how it works. Then you don't have to buy your own server. Again, knowing what they have on campus is super useful. You know, does your university offer seed funding to pilot projects? So I know your campus IT has done a little bit of this. But looking at things like your State Humanities Council, usually the grants are only $5,000 to $10,000 a piece, but $5,000 to $10,000 will buy you hours and hours of time on your project. And what about your library? So at Maryland, we're very lucky. We have an incredibly supportive dean who has done some really great things with us and for us, in part because we're mutually constitutive between the library and the college. You know, what does the library want as its goals? You know, does it have this incredible collection that it really wishes people came to visit?
Yes.
So the answer is yes. So what is your collection? What is it that you want people to come visit and see?
Numerous.
Okay, so I will tell you, I was at Bowling Green State in Ohio giving this version somewhat of this thing, and I was sitting in a workshop where they were lamenting the fact that nobody ever came to the library. And one of the librarians was showing that they just actually scanned and digitized a bunch of WWE, which is a wrestling federation, like memorabilia, like a bunch of material culture. And I said, why the hell didn't you build a digital humanities project around that? And she said, well, we wanted to let people know it was here. We haven't really thought about what we're going to do with it. It was on the list of things we needed to digitize. But it's super cool because nobody's actually, you know, like nobody knows it's here. And I said, what's interesting is in 3 weeks, the WWE is going to be right down the road in Dayton, Ohio. This would be a great time to write the WWE and say, why don't you and some of your celebrity people come on up to Bowling Green and see our collection of all of your memorabilia? And they said, oh. They're like a $15 million a year industry. We could probably hit them up for money when they came. Again, knowing what you have in-house and thinking strategically about how you can build around it. So what part of the reason why they wanted to do the project is because Bowling Green is very well known in its popular studies department for issues of studying sexuality and race. And the WWE memorabilia in particular is so highly sexualized and masculinized that like the students could go to town for years writing theses and dissertations on it. They had no idea that it had been digitized because nobody was talking to each other. So making those things publicly available, telling people what you have and what you want done special. And so externally, you know, how do you find resources or how do you get started? Join an existing project. dhcommons.org, I hope you've heard of. DH Commons is a dating site for digital humanities. People go on and they list their projects, they list the things that they need. People go on and list the skills that they have, and you can literally hire somebody for free. Oftentimes, they donate time. A lot of times, these are advanced graduate students or even early career scholars who are looking to build their CVs, or actually people like myself who are out there in the community who are happy to donate some time when they have it. So a lot of my colleagues on the ACH Executive Board donate their time to projects because they believe in what the project is trying to do. Get educated. Go to some place like MITH, that's the URL for our training institute, or DHSI. We offer week-long intensive, it's the equivalent of a graduate class in 5 days. You two were there in January. You can speak a little bit about how traumatic it was to do an entire graduate course in 5 days. But it's a great way to get competent, or at least get semi-competent in a really short amount of time on a particular approach or technology. Ask a question. Don't be shy. If you can't tell by Twitter, digital humanists like to talk a lot. If you can't tell by me, we like to talk a lot. Ask a question. So dhanswers.org, you can post questions and surf people's responses. What's the best GIS technology? You know, can somebody recommend a server who allows you to do these types of things? Can somebody point me to a syllabus about how I would teach a class in literature with games? You'd be amazed at the resources that are already available. And follow the DH hashtag and DH folk on Twitter, myself. You have Tracy here produces the Daily Digest for the University of Delaware, where she reposts things from digital humanities. I follow every funder under the sun, because they talk about the projects they're funding. And then I follow those people. And then I follow those people's friends. It's actually a really great way to get your project networked and to talk about it. Twitter's a fun little thing. Don't get obsessed, though. It's a little easy to become obsessed. So where I actually want to end is to talk about the fact that you actually don't have to have a center to be a digital humanist. And in fact, I've been recommending to people, don't ever get a center. All you really need is people committed to doing this, and you need deans and university provosts who are willing to provide the resources that already exist on campus. And then once you've done that for a little while and you have a little track record of local success, that's then when you go and ask for more things. Ask for more money, ask for more support, ask for new resources. So for example, MITH is actually in the process of getting ready to start an external review. And part of the reason why we're doing an external review, which the university is requiring for the first time in the 15-year history of MITH, is because about 5 months ago, I proposed an innovative new master's in digital humanities education that is a multi-state consortial model that has never been done in the US. That's an 18-month accelerated master's. And the college said, holy shit, that's a little scary. We might want to actually know that you guys know what you're doing before we decide to throw a bunch of money into tenure track hires and to creating a whole new curriculum around this. So we're going to take our lumps with a study that will tell us things that we may or may not want to know. But once that study's done, we've done our bona fides with the university, and we can start to build the thing that we really want. It took us 15 years to get there, though. You know, you don't have to do it all overnight. Just start with one thing that you all agree on. And I've talked a little bit with Anne about how you start getting people to agree a little bit. So everybody always likes to know when I do these talks, how the hell do you know all this stuff or where is this all coming from? I have a massive website, devdh.org, which is the acronym or abbreviation for Develop DH. There are 21 lectures of an hour or longer with slide decks and podcasts, resources, there are example grants, there's example readings. It's a good destination for getting started with your first project because I cover everything from publicity and budgets to funding streams to how do you write that damned humanities significance statement that must be less than 500 words. You can follow us on Twitter at DevelopDH. But it's a really great resource to sort of get started. It also has a link to a lecture on building a center, which is quite useful. So that's my spiel for this evening. I'm happy to talk about anything I've said or anything I didn't say that you want to know about. Because inevitably there are questions I don't cover that people want to know about. Oh, of course. Yeah?
I've got one for you, Jen. When you talk about what constitutes return on investment, how are colleges and universities quantifying DH?
So a little bit of, you know, internal investment.
Did you repeat the question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, I was asking when she was talking about what constitutes the return on investment, how are colleges and universities quantifying DH?
So when we talk about return on investment, universities across the board, regardless of whether it's digital humanities or not, tend to use three different metrics. The first one is considered scholarly output. So it's the tenure stuff that they look for. You know, how many books are you writing? How many articles have you gotten? How many grants have you won? The sort of traditional faculty achievement things you must have. So that's one metric. You can use things like the MLA guidelines for digital tenure to sort of push on that. So they accept things like digital projects, for example, now are considered commensurate to a book in the amount of work that it takes. Anne and I have talked a little bit about this. That's something that's very useful for you guys as a community to sort of negotiate. So that's one metric, is sort of the traditional scholarly metric. As much as the university likes to say it cares about the scholarly metric, it really doesn't. The university, as an academic institution in the United States, really has two other things that it judges us by, which is the number of butts that enroll in the university and how much money you bring in when you do it. So when I talk about return on investment for digital humanities, I provide lists of all of the faculty and all of the partners we have to show exactly how big our network is. And every time somebody enrolls in our university and says they come because they want to work with a digital humanist, I get them to write me a little 2 or 3 sentence blurb that says exactly that, or send me an email that tells me their story of why they came to the University of Maryland. And this way, every time one of the deans says, well, what are you really doing with students? What, you know, you're not, you guys don't teach really. Why should we support you when we're an educational institution? I pull out things like my metrics from DHWI, where I have emails from people in Australia saying, we sent one person there and it's ignited our campus. You know, so qualitative sort of moments can be very useful. Telling a story to the institution about how you're involving undergraduates and graduates in your research, that's considered a return on investment that they very clearly understand, because they can go to a state representative and say, yeah, you know, we may not have this, but I've got 300 students over the course of the last 5 years that have been involved in this program, and those 300 students have gotten jobs supporting institutions in the state of Delaware. So that's the second rationale. The third rationale is the money thing. They want to know that for every dollar they put in, they get 2, sometimes 3 back. But there's an interesting change that you can make. Every time an administrator talks to me about how much money we bring in, I talk about how much PR value we have. So yeah, last year I brought in $600,000 to MIT as part of my role as an assistant director. We brought in, I think the figure was $1.2 million in the last 2 years. That's a great number. For humanists, that's like winning the freaking lottery. Because most humanists at this stage in their game, in their lifetime as a scholar, will bring in maybe $30,000 as a fellow. I mean, that's kind of normal for most scholars at this point. You know, we bring in 10, 20, 30 times that in a year. I always talk about how you may have only given us a dollar, but I turn that dollar into PR that can be used when the university is out there talking to its donors. So I write little blurbs and stories about the projects. I ask project PIs to tell us what's important about their project to the public. You know, we're getting ready on October 31st to launch the Shelley Godwin Archive at the New York Public Library. So it was a $200,000 grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities. We're launching it on October 31st because we're launching it with Frankenstein. Everybody cares, because you know what? At Halloween, what does everybody talk about? Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. They play it on TV. You can buy it as a costume. It's a PR story our university can sell to everybody. You know, so that's the third metric, and that's where every time I get pushed about money, we're not bringing in enough money, we're not doing whatever, I tell stories about us being asked to give talks here or give talks wherever, or, you know, I talk about students using the resources we've created in the classroom. It's an ecosystem, and you want to treat it like an ecosystem when you talk about return on investment. So it doesn't always have to be about the money. It can oftentimes be about the university's priorities. Yeah?
You mentioned the students. Is it also a metric what students are getting in terms of training and preparation for an alternative career?
Definitely. So MIT is, it's chartered as a research center. However, I am one of three faculty at MIT who teach regularly. So Neil and Matt, two of our directors, teach in the English department most regularly. I teach in both the Digital Cultures program in the Honors College, but also in the Department of History. So we are the overload, I'm the overload that everybody calls and says, we have to have a digital humanities class on the books. We need somebody to come in and teach. So I just taught a research methodologies class for the Honors College. I also taught a digital narratives class that they used for their degree requirements. You know, what's really useful about this is you don't just want to offer DH classes, but you want to go back to the classes that are requirements and cores of your departments and say, how would we reimagine this as a 21st century class? And this is one of the things that I talk a lot about when people say, well, we should just scrap everything we do with majors and minors and move entirely to a digital curriculum. Well, you know what? Reimagine teaching the US survey with all of the new digital material that's available. That's a challenge for the instructor to do it, but you know what? Students have more engagement with the Library of Congress digital materials than they're ever going to have going to see the Declaration of Independence. You know, how do you take the courses you already have on the books and strategize as a department or strategize as a group of faculty about how to use them more effectively? One of the things when I first took my job at the University of South Carolina that sort of surprised the deans and the university provost when I met with him was, one of the things I said very clearly was, the reason why you want every student on your campus to be engaged with digital humanities is because I don't know of anybody who works in any institution or any organization in the world that does not have to deal with digital technologies anymore. You either have to email, you have to post, you have to search a database, you have to Google it. Google it is a digital humanities issue. It's an algorithm running behind a bunch of data. It's an HCI, human-computer interaction problem. So having students who understand how Google spits out its results is going to help a business that's trying to increase its advertising profile or who's trying to get a bigger share of the market. Telling stories like that to your institution is really useful. So I survey students when they're done working on our projects and they go get jobs. What is it you learned on this job, in this project, that you've now taken to your job? Tell me. Write me a story. Write me an email. And I collect all those in little files. And when I get asked to provide excellence for merit raises, or when I get asked to, you know, produce a teaching portfolio when I'm on the market, I include all that stuff. Because that's just as valuable as what they learned in the 16 hours of class they had with me. Yeah?
So one of the things that I would like to see happen is a shift from what used to be the traditional librarian-faculty collaboration in planning using traditional primary sources. Mm-hmm. For a traditional research methods class. And you know, it sets it up perfectly to build DH projects where you have this primary source material that's on site and it's still original on your campus.
Yep.
But you deliver it in a new way in tandem with the faculty to build the projects that can be sustained in future coursework as you're talking about.
Yep.
But how to get that conversation going?
Sure.
Not just all this talk about collaboration, but it's almost like
how to really do it.
Of like, what are the teaching goals and what is the valuable source material? So we plan that infrastructure together, you know, and then we seek the technical expertise to deliver it.
So I can give you a good example of how you can make that collaboration start and work. I have a colleague in the library who is a language librarian. She's assigned to the French and Portuguese department. She also serves as our digital humanities liaison. Her name is Kelsey. Kelsey came to my project management class because Kelsey was told in her job that she really needed to learn how to sort of manage various teams and aspects.
What's her last name?
Corlett Rivera. So Kelsey came to my class, and she took my class, and one of the things that I make the class do is they have to come up with a project. Even if they're not really interested in it, they have to come up with a project. Kelsey's project for the week was actually not to come up with a project, but was to identify what are the things that she did in her job every day that she felt could be useful to humanists. So she's supposed to work with the faculty and the departments to order their books and to make sure she trains their students when they come in to do stuff. And what she identified was that there were faculty in the French department who were really interested in the French Revolution. And it just so happens that the University of Maryland Special Collections had a catalog of French pamphlets that had never been actually appropriately collated and metadata and all of that stuff. They'd basically done it roughly. So Kelsey went to the faculty member and said, I have a really interesting proposal for you. Like, I know you're starting this new book where you want to be working with these pamphlet materials. What if we partnered together and like figured this out? We can apply to the college for a little bit of seed money to hire some students who will come in and translate basically the metadata, the titles, the subject matter, the pamphlets. So the library gets better data for its catalog, which is what the library cared about. Faculty member gets her students having experience with primary sources, and in fact gets to then take the primary sources and use them in their book. That all came about because Kelsey identified that her job was to create partnerships with the faculty beyond just buying their books. And so she went to them and said, tell me what your research is right now. What are you working on? And then she went back to her desk and said, well, what do we have here that could help them do their research? Oftentimes, collaboration isn't about putting six people in a room and saying, collaborate. I mean, there are people who can do that, very few. Oftentimes, what it's about is somebody saying, I had a random idea, and I thought about this, and like, I'm calling you because I know you have an interest in this. So what could you put on this project? So in the case of this French pamphlets project, I advised them, helped them write a short, it's like a two-page grant application to the college. They got, I think it was $10,000 from the college to hire undergraduate and graduate students who speak French to do this metadata work. The library, in return for the 10 grand, kicked in time from its cataloging and metadata librarians to help guide the graduate students and train them how to do the work. They then, after 6 months of the project running as a pilot project, have now applied to the University of Florida, who has the National French Pamphlets Project, to join. And in fact, because of the way that we built our project, where they were creating the standards, our project is being used as the basis for what the national project is going to do, because we've already figured out the encoding, the TEI schema, the metadata schema, because we had to do that locally in-house. That's a good example where somebody's saying, my job is to do X. I need to find out what everybody else wants out of X, and then we'll create something around it. And you've got one of those. I mean, your project on colored conventions is that sort of way. Like, you had an idea as a scholar, and you have lots of people join in, and you've got graduate students join in, and you've got all kinds of people sort of on board. You know, have you gone and talked to the library about what they can contribute to the project? Yep. See? But have you now gone and talked to the university PR people about it? See? But those are things where a lot of times when we say collaboration, it's code for like everybody just jumping on board and like doing something. That's really not what good collaboration is. Good collaboration starts from we have a goal, and we're going to identify the steps it takes to get to the goal and who the people are that we need to be involved. So for example, I would take your project to Anne and say, hey, Anne, can we get the project featured in whatever publicity material and promotional materials is coming out for the college? Because we're using undergraduate and graduate students, and that's the kind of thing donors really like when they're looking at portfolios for the college. You know, thinking a little bit strategically about those types of things. Collaboration doesn't always have to be about scholarly collaboration. It can be about business and publishing and finance just as much. Other questions? Dirty secrets you'd like me to reveal? I tend to be very candid. I know we're close to the end of time.
What's a dirty secret we would be most interested in?
The one that's getting the most controversy at the moment coming out of Myth is that we're actually doing away with our fellowship model. So Myth has a long history, in part because Myth was founded off of the template that was started at IATH in the 70s and 80s. We're doing away with individual faculty fellowships. And in fact, started this process last year. We run something called the Digital Humanities Incubator. Last year, we ran it with the librarians. This year, we're going to run it across the campus with both the college and the librarians, where we bring them in and we actually provide them with hands-on workshops to learn. And at the end, there's a pitch round, and they pitch their project. And they get support by pitching their project. So other librarians can sign on to work with them. We hand-selected two in this last round that we provided a bunch of staff time and resources to. The French Pamphlets Project actually came out in part of the incubator process, but we're doing away with one-on-one relationships to some extent because it doesn't work very well for us. We're not a big enough shop. It does when you have a larger staff, but we're not that big anymore. So I can put a room of 40 people together and teach project management, and that's 40 people who learn. If I only do it in a room with one faculty member, that one faculty member just walks away. So we're moving away from that, which is a bit controversial. Yeah?
So you talked about kind of your DH experience with teaching courses, or your experience teaching DH courses.
Yeah.
In my opinion, it feels as if we often, as instructors, use digital tools to discuss source materials with our students, right? Newspapers, maps.
Yep.
As a point of, you know, making a larger statement or shaping their understanding of a period. But what's your advice on teaching projects with a narrative attached to our own, and then sustaining like that teaching for a length of time so they can develop research and writing from it?
So I'm actually going to be doing this spring. I'm teaching the digital history undergraduate-graduate split, and the course is called Building and Critiquing Digital History. So we're actually going to start the course, and I did this with my undergrads in the Honors College this past spring. I start with them creating a traditional narrative. So they have to start by writing a two-page essay on a topic of their choice. They then come to class, and we re-envision that as a digital narrative. So we just move it into a digital space. So which multimedia pieces would you add in? Which primary sources could you link off of? We basically turn it into hypertext fiction or hypertext nonfiction. And then after they've done that and everybody gets to comment, we come back and I say, okay, you can no longer use text. How do you tell the same story with no text? And we look at tools, for example, like Scalar out of the University of Southern California's Institute for Multimedia Literacy, which allows you to take video and create pathways. We look at things like Neatline. And their semester project is to actually create their own. What you'll find, though, is some students aren't really comfortable with creating. And so the parallel exercise that will be going on simultaneously will be them critiquing existing digital projects. So for example, go read the chapter on the Civil War. Now go pick a Civil War digital history project, and I want you to critique that project in 2 pages. What do they include? What do they miss? What's wrong with the menus that they have? Maybe the aesthetics are screwed up. Maybe they're missing evidence that they really need. I'm trying to get to the point with the class, what I'd like to see happen is that they do those critiques and we batch them all up and ship them to something like the Journal of Digital Humanities or one of the other Digital Humanities Now, so that all of those projects get those critiques publicly, because students are users. And so having students critique is just, it's the same exercise we do in graduate school. It's a rhetorical essay. And we do this in graduate school all the time, but we just don't do it publicly. And so that's what I'm going to do for the spring, is test this with an undergraduate-graduate split of like, what happens when you say to them, your job is to be a scholar in the way a faculty member must be a scholar, because you don't just get to produce shit, you also have to critique it, and you have to be aware of the way your stuff is being perceived. So we're going to try a parallel approach, and we'll see what lives after it's been done. With my undergraduate honor students, they concentrated primarily on critiquing in the first half of the class, and then the second half of the class was them building. And they produced some really interesting stuff, including things like a geolocative mobile app. This kid was really interested in surveillance, and he mapped all of the surveillance cameras on campus. Because he took a class where they were learning about GIS, and they were learning about surveillance and you know, all the Foucauldian high theory, and he came in and said, I want to build an app so that if I wanted to avoid every surveillance camera on campus, I could. You know, but that's the type of thing, I mean, when we talk about digital humanities, part of the reasons why a lot of people go to digital humanities is because it allows you to be creative with your scholarship in ways that, it's not that your department doesn't want you to be, it's just that they don't quite know how to judge you for it. And let me tell you, it isn't easy no matter how long you've been doing this. It's one of the reasons why with my students and with people who come to train with me, I talk a lot about how you present your work. You know, if you don't believe in your work being important and you can't communicate clearly why it's valuable to the most conservative member of your discipline, whether they believe it or not, then you're not doing your job. And that's something I really believe in. You know, when I talk about my projects, I imagine I'm talking to my mother, who, you know, graduated high school and lived in a generation where she didn't get to go to college. She went straight to work at 18 and got a nursing degree, raised four children in a military family, and had she been of my generation, who knows what she'd be doing. But I imagine her, you know, somebody who likes to watch the nightly news but isn't necessarily going to care about Foucauldian theory or, you know, the arguments between Spivak and Said and Butler about whatever. You know, she doesn't really care. She wants to get to the evidence. She wants to get to the cool stuff. And that's how I reimagine, that's how I imagine digital humanities, is it's about taking the cool stuff that we do and being very open about it and saying, I may not have all the answers, jump on and add in. So it's a little different, yeah.
So I was taken by many things, but by that, the map that is exploding with ever-increasing dots
yes.
of centers. And you framed it in relationship to differentiating the vision of your own institution and its agenda, because you're going to be competing for resources
yep.
with other folks who are also building, are putting their bubbles yep. on the map. So I'm wondering if we can talk about it from how we can prepare our graduate students, mm-hmm. Because it also means exploding jobs,
yep.
but it also means exploding jobs based on soft money,
yep.
right? And you also talked about you're trying to change your position into yep. a tenure track position. So if one of the reasons, one of our investments in digital humanities projects is so that our students have a wide array of skills in a shrinking market,
right?
How can we start to think about equipping them so that they can move into those tenure track positions
yep.
and bring the college soft money rather than be dependent on it?
I mean, I think there's, to some extent, there's sort of two responses to this. The first is that I think it's important to maintain the integrity of continuing to encourage students to look for tenure track positions. You know, part of the reason why tenure track positions are so attractive is, whether it's accurate or not, there's a perception that when you're in a tenured position, you have the freedom to do risky things. I mean, that's sort of the backbone of the tenure system in the US, is that when you become tenured, you can go do that crazy project that others may not understand, and you have some protection.
Or you can have health care.
Or you can have healthcare. I mean, it doesn't make sense. I guess one of the things that I sort of, part of the reason, I'll tell this as a personal narrative, part of the reason why I'm pushing to change over to a tenure track position is that it is very difficult for me in my current position to accommodate my own individual scholarly impulse, because I help run 20-some different projects with PhDs, non-PhDs, students, non-students, I mean, I spend a tremendous amount of my time shepherding other people's projects, and that works very well for a while, but it's really hard when you have multiple book contracts or you have these things that you're really passionate about. I've gotten so far away from what I'm passionate about. You know, I got into the academy to read really cool books and talk to really cool people and teach, because I love to teach. And I don't get to do that in my current position. So for me, part of the tenure track move is about going back to the things that are the reasons why I got into this position. I think though, when we look at how we educate students, it's important to recognize that, you know, there's an ever increasing pressure on the bureaucracy and the infrastructure of higher education in the US. I don't know in 50 years if we're gonna be looking at as many institutions in brick and mortar form as we are. So I tend to treat educating the next generation of scholars as providing them with the widest possible array of skills and options. So if you imagine tomorrow that every institution in the United States of higher education shut down, what would your students need to know to go work for Procter & Gamble, or to go work for LexisNexis, or to go enroll in the military even? You know, I think it's a mistake sometimes that we fall into thinking that we should make our students in the image of ourselves. And I think, to be frank, that's what we've been told is a lot of the problem with the academy, is that we think, create the student that you wanted to be when you were a student. Well, Jesus Christ, I mean, if I was doing that, I'd be in trouble. Like, I didn't know what the hell, you know, it's impossible. I think when we talk about it, I go back to some extent to the basic skills that we teach kindergartners. How to read, how to write, how to think critically, how to be good citizens with each other. I mean, it sounds really stupid and simple, but I have six nieces and nephews from the age of 9 to 1.5. And the shit that they learn as little kids is the shit that I'm still trying to convince faculty to do at 55 and 60, or my colleagues to do at 30 and 35 when they show up late for meetings. You know, that's not appropriate behavior. You need to show up on time. You know, I tend to think about what are those core things that make you successful human beings. And it's a bit utopian of me, But I think if we educate our students to be good citizens in the humanistic sense, everybody wins. Because that may be somebody who goes and creates a really cool exhibit for the Smithsonian that changes the mind of some child about how they feel about a particular race or ethnicity. It may be somebody who writes better copyright for those dumbass manuals that you get from IKEA. So that, you know, you never know. You never know. I mean, and I think that's the thing to sort of step back from is, don't worry so much about remaking people in the image of the academy now. Make them in the image of what you want the academy to be. And it's a little utopian, but I was trained by labor historians who believe utopia is coming, so this could be why.
And on that note, thank you.
Thank you.